It's a cloud bursting, and no batting practice before the ball game. Jamie Quirk will manage the club this evening. Clint Hurdle is back in Denver with his wife, Carla, their young daughter, Madison, who's two, has suffered from several seizures the last couple of days. She is resting comfortably, the last word we have, at Children's Hospital. So obviously our thoughts and best wishes and prayers right now with Clint and Carla and their family. And Clint obviously where he needs to be, back in Denver, and he'll be there tomorrow as well. And beyond that, we don't know at this point. So today, Jamie Quirk will manage the club as Clint Barmas fouls it back. Tomorrow, Jamie Quirk will be going to Kansas City. One of his children, one of his sons, will be graduating high school tomorrow. So the ball club tomorrow will be managed combination of Bob Apodaca, the pitching coach, and Dwayne Espy, the hitting coach, and Dwayne, a minor league manager on several occasions. And again, Oliver Perez has his pitch fouled straight back. Perez trying to pound the strike zone. He has struggled with his control, and he's ahead 0-2 early.
He has walked 25 batters so far this year, and that is not the norm for him. And his career, 449 and two-thirds innings, 503 strikeouts, and just 231 walks.
Barmas has seen Oliver Perez on one occasion. He has a base hit against him.
Yeah, it was last year, wasn't it? Here where Barmas was called up for one day and sent back to the minor leagues.
Inside, 2-2. Calling balls and strikes, Mike DeMuro. Mark Carlson's at first base. The crew chief, Joe West, at second base. Brian Gorman at third base. It's beautiful out right now. They couldn't even get the tarp down on the field. That cloudburst came so quickly. This ball is driven left center field, and it'll be cut off by Jason Bay. Let's take a look at the rest of the lineup as drawn up by Jamie Quirk. Luis Gonzalez at first base, batting in the two-hole. Atkins, as we talked about, hits three. Todd Green, who's been swinging a great bat, will bat cleanup. Preston Wilson drops to five. Holiday, six. Dustin Moore, seven. And Desi Relaford will be at second base, hitting eight. Then Jennings. Luis Gonzalez, 269, a couple of home runs. And he fouls it back.
You know, one pitch that Perez relied on heavily was a slider that he could throw extremely hard, change the direction, the plane of the baseball, and get his strikeout. He's not been able to locate that pitch consistently early in the 2005 season.
Lloyd McClendon sitting on 299 career wins. Loop to shallow right. This could be a problem. Guess not. Jose Castillo, with great quickness, gets at the short right field and tucks it away.
Now let's take a look at Oliver Perez's numbers based on this year. 1-4, the high earned run average, 37 innings, 25 walks, way too many. The opponent average above 300. No command of the strike zone. Talked about his walk speed is still there. Has a nasty slider. He just hasn't been able to locate it.
Came up with the Padres. And his stuff is electric. Last year, he went 12-10 with a 2.98 ERA. Give you an idea how good he was. In 196 innings, he gave up just 145 hits. And Matt Lawton and Tyke Redmond almost bump heads. The ball is. I don't know if they can see inside the ballpark from that vantage point on the Allegheny, but I don't know if they really care. They may get a home run ball. Last night, Matt Lawton one hopped one into the Allegheny, only 13th time it's been done. Here's Lloyd McClendon's lineup. Matt Lawton, Jack Wilson. Starting to swing a hot bat, six hits for Wilson over his last couple of ball games. Bay, Darryl Ward, Jose Castillo, Mikowiak, who homered a three-run shot last night. Tyke Redmond 4-for-4 last night. The only difference in their lineup, other than the pitcher, is Humberto Cota is catching in batting eight instead of David Ross. Cota's got a little pop in his bat. So here we go, Jason Jennings to Matt Lawton. And first pitch swinging in the air, shallow right center field. Here comes Dustin Moore, one out.
Well, to take a look at Jason Jennings' numbers now over the course of the year, they're not at all what he would like for them to be, particularly the walks. 33 and 48 innings. That has been a downfall for Jason. With a 6.19 earned run average, blackout your old performer. 0-3 in his last start, needs to be ahead in the strike zone. When ahead, you see the opponent's average, 176. And put hitters away. There's been the last couple of starts, a lot of 0-2, 1-2, 2-2 counts that end up in walks or base hits. Talked with Bob Apodaca about Jennings yesterday, and instead of trying to make the perfect pitch, make a pitch. Just a rely on your stuff to do the work.
Line drive that Moore will get to. So Jack Wilson is retired. He obviously is feeling more and more comfortable at the plate after struggling mightily the first 6 weeks. Defensively brought to you by Rico Holiday, Wilson, Moore in the outfield. Atkins at third, Barmas at short. Relaford, his first start this year at second base. Luis Gonzalez, obviously, his first start this year at first base. He played there in Double A. He made one appearance there this year late in a blowout for help. Other than that, Todd has started every ball game at first base this year. Gonzo, so versatile. He carries about 13 gloves with him on the road. Fouled off by Jason Bay. And it's quickly 0-2. There's Todd. Probably doesn't know what to do with himself.
He'll drive a manager crazy by the end of the game. Down by Jamie Quirk, Gallego.
And that pitch down low, 1-2. See you later on a slider away. So a very good start for two pitchers who need to start well. An 8-pitch inning for Jason Jennings after known as the Steel City, but now the number one business, probably health care, higher education. As you look at the Rico defensive alignment, Bay, Tyke Redmond, Matt Lawton in the outfield, Makoviak, Wilson, Castillo, and Ward in the infield. Cota's behind the plate, catching Oliver Perez. Of course, Pittsburgh, the home of the University of Pittsburgh, the Pitt Panthers. Great academic institution, Carnegie Mellon, Duquesne University. Todd Green right at 300. Hitting 360, in fact, over his last six starts, and he gets the big sweeping curveball for a strike. One ball and one strike on Green. 2-for-4 in his career against Oliver Perez. Turned on and whacked into the upper deck, foul. Hit the roof of that restaurant. Two balls, two strikes on Green. 19th start tonight behind the plate for Green. J.D. Closser has 22 starts behind the plate. Mike Gallego has to jump out of the way.
Let's take a look at Oliver Perez's delivery, and you see him square up here. Everything's pointed towards the first base bag. He's not square to the mound. Now all of a sudden he's trying to square himself up, freeze it. See, all this looks really good except for the leg. That should be tucked underneath. That allows this to stop from rocking back on top and then to get out over that front leg. And if you notice the follow through, although he gets a strikeout here, the follow through of his arm. The follow through of his left arm when it comes across the body versus out over the front leg on his follow through. And you'll be able to see it as he gets out over this front leg. And go ahead and let it come on through, guys. Let it come on through. And watch the arm as it comes through the zone. See how it comes across the body versus on through, and you see that follow through third base side. If you're out of sync at all, the ball's going to be up and out of the strike zone, and your curveball will be extremely flat.
Wilson 1-for-4 last night, 248 average, steps in with one out. You know, Oliver Perez has been off, went over his last two ball games. In 10 1/3 innings, he has struck out just two. He's walked seven during that time. He's a guy, George, that used to mess around with his arm slot, drop down. Used to drive them nuts in San Diego. Here in Pittsburgh, they got him to throw consistently out of one arm slot, but he still on occasion would drop down.
Well, exactly. When he does that, it's just very difficult to have control of the pitches. He's very headstrong, going to pitch the way he'd been successful as a young kid. Not realizing that when you get here, the last man on a 25-man roster can still beat you in a ball game. Ben Williams has done his best to try to straighten him out. Just has not happened.
Oliver for president. Well, president of what? You know what tonight is at the ballpark? It's Oliver Perez bobblehead night. Three-two on Wilson. He got locked up. Did he go? No swing.
Good job of not committing, not following through with the bat, and then selling it to the umpire.
So Holiday hitting an even 300 over his last eight ball games, takes ball one. Matt, along with several others, out for early batting practice this afternoon for the Rockies. They typically do that the second day in. That pitch misses. Included in that group was Aaron Miles, who's feeling better and better, but the Rockies will give him another day off in the hope that he can start tomorrow. Nursing a little muscle strain in his upper back. Good swing by Holiday, 2-1. Rockies just 2-16 on the road. Todd Helton and company on a Milwaukee after the ball game tomorrow. 3 in Milwaukee. And then 4 on the north side of Chicago. Guess what? The White Sox beat the Cubs again, 5-3. Mets earlier today beat Randy Johnson and the Yankees. Angels beat the Dodgers earlier. Ball four. So Holiday walks right behind Wilson. One out, two on for Dustin Moore. Moore started last night in right field, and Desi Relliford later on in the ballgame pinch hit for him. Chance for Moore to do some early damage. Doesn't pull the trigger, and here comes Cota to talk to Perez.
Now, part of the reason Cota is catching him is because they seem to have a good working relation. They think along the same lines. Cota get after him a little bit on the mound as a backup guy that works with him, catches him on the the side frequently. Lloyd McClendon is only frustrated because of the results that Cota can't get out of Perez.
Well, Cota, like Perez from Mexico. Wilson at second, Holiday at first. Good speed aboard. And a little tardy with the swing. Moore with a 2-2 count. That last fastball at 93 miles an hour. So some of the velocity coming back apparently for Oliver Perez. He has not started since May the 6th. On the inside corner, strike three.
Constantly work you to the outside part of the plate with some heat elevated in the strike zone and into paint. The inside part caught and framed brilliantly by Cota.
Second strikeout for Oliver Perez.
And again, Moore with an opportunity to drive in a run, disappointed with the call that went against him.
Relaford with two outs will try to pick him up. Desi hitting 364 on the road, second best road average on the club. And they check it out at first with Mark Carlson, no swing. It's really turned into a very pleasant evening here in Pittsburgh. Somewhat cool night, as it was last night. But the ball traveled pretty well last night. We saw a few home runs. Atkins and Sullivan for the Rockies. Mikoviak and Lott for Pittsburgh. That's in there 2-1. Earlier this season, when Clint Hurdle was battling the flu, Jamie Quirk managed the club. Three and one.
Well, who gets the loss and who gets the win today?
They're still attached to Clint Hurdle's record. There's the breakdown, home and road. See how aggressive Perez is with Jennings on deck. He threw one in the strike zone. Relaford chops it foul. Three balls, two strikes on Desi.
I think when you have the type of stuff that Perez does, Drew, I think you go ahead even though you're struggling. That you are able to throw it by people or throw the nasty slider, that you're not worried about who's in on the deck circle. You're confident you can strike out the eight hole hitter and lead off with Jennings in the next inning.
Strike three on the inside corner. Perez with the hit of a glove pump, and then he slaps his bare hand into the open glove, trying to get it back together with two on. He gets a couple of. With George Frazier, I'm Drew Goodman. That first pitch to Darryl Ward's out of the strike zone. Ward at 276 with eight long balls, and he has driven in 20.
Coors Field, not only a great place to play baseball, great place to have your special event also. For more information, call 303-312-2552.
This ball's hit a long way straight away. Wilson going back, still going back, will get there on the warning track. Darryl Ward a long out. Pirates after a miserable start playing much better. They began the season 4-11. They're 14-10 for Lloyd McClendon the last 24. And when you think of fiery managers in baseball, now that Larry Boa is doing television, Lloyd McClendon may be at the top of the stack.
Yeah, he can lose it pretty quick, but usually he is justified by losing it. And I think he's a guy that is frustrated. He wants to win as a manager, because when named as manager here, a lot of people second guess the fact that they hired him in Pittsburgh. This is his fifth season. First couple of years he worked alongside Bill Verdon, a very successful manager with Houston and here in Pittsburgh. And pick his brain an awful lot about how to run a ball club, how to run a locker room. And Bill decided to retire. He's filled his own staff in with people he wants around him.
Base hit for Jose Castillo. Pete McCannon is now his bench coach. Diamond Details brought to you by Diamond Shamrock. 13 home runs have reached the Allegheny River. The only one on a fly by Darryl Ward. Interestingly, he hit it not when he was with Pittsburgh, but when he was playing for the Houston Astros. One out, one on for Mikowiak. And as Jennings has done each of the first three hitters this inning, he's fallen behind 2-0. Coming up on a very important date for Rob Mikowiak. Next week, next Saturday, his son Garrett will turn one. What a way he welcomed in his son into the world. That pitch misses Mikowiak to first. After the birth of his son last year, he went to the park 9 hours later. In the first of a doubleheader, he had a walk-off grand slam. In the ninth inning of game two, he had a two-run home run to tie it, eventually won by the Pirates in the 10th inning. And the next day, he hit another home run. I asked him yesterday, so what are you going to do for an encore? He said, I don't know if that'll ever happen again.
More than likely, that won't happen again.
The adrenaline was flowing last year on May 28th, obviously, from Mikowiak. Oh, man, that was very close. Barmas got the tag down on Castillo, but Joe West said the hand was in.
Well, I know, and I think Joe West may have been caught off guard a little bit by this. Comes in, slapped right in front of the hand before the hand got to the bat.
Now Tyke Redmond challenged by his manager to start getting things going. As you look at Mark Redmond, we want to talk about Tyke Redmond. Mark Redmond was good yesterday also. They got their Redmonds confused. And that pitch tails away, and again it's 2-0, fourth straight hitter. And this is a pattern that Jennings has struggled with not only this year, but really, George, throughout his career.
Well, he's just fighting his own self. I mean, he's got tremendous stuff. I mean, it's over the plate, it's as electric as anybody in baseball. But as you consistently work behind and have that one big inning, Jennings talks about the last three starts having three bad innings. Well, they're bad. Six runs into one inning that he was referencing to. Typically, it's because he falls behind the hitters. He has the ability, the stuff, to win 15 games a year in the big leagues. Just a matter of harnessing it.
3-0. He's got starting to say Lloyd McClendon has challenged Tyke Redmond to take ownership of center field, but he said you have to produce more than a 208 average. Redmond 4-for-4 last night. That's taking some ownership, and that's downstairs. And now the bases are loaded with one out. A single by Jose Castillo, who was ahead in the count, and then back-to-back walks to Mikowiak and Redmond bring up Cota, and it also brings Bob Apodaca to the mound in early meeting.
Yeah, not a lot much you can say now if you're the pitching coach other than get the ball in the strike zone, knowing that he's not trying to throw balls, but he is. Coors Field's a great place to entertain any group schedule with clients, employees, family. Check out a great entertainment packages available in the party suites, the warding track party room, and picnic areas. Call today and take advantage of the buy one suite, get second suite free. How about that, huh? An offer throughout the entire season. 303-312-2444.
Cota fouls off the first delivery, 0-1.
And a perfect scenario set up for Jennings with Cota up and Perez in the on deck circle. Perez yet to have a hit this year in 12 at bats. Cota has power, but average is down. 11 hits and 50 at bats so far.
This ball rifled down the left field line. This will score at least two, maybe three. Around third comes Redmond, and he will score a three-run double off the bat of Humberto Cota. So Jennings walks two, and they all come around.
You get to fastball counts and then you try to throw a slider for a strike, and it's difficult to do. The ball hung right in the middle of the plate. One hopped off the left field wall. And you can see that Redmond with pretty good speed, he's going to score ahead of the throw from Barmas.
Cota goes back. Perez retired for the second out. 3-0 Pittsburgh. They took a 3-0 lead last night. Rockies carved into it. It was 3-2 going to the bottom of the seventh, and then the Rockies would give up six at the bottom of the seventh, and it wasn't much of a contest after that. Matt Lawton flied to right his first time up. George, the control just comes and goes in the first inning. Jennings was aggressive, threw a lot of strikes, not a 1-2-3 inning.
7 out of 8 pitches thrown in the first were strikes.
This ball lined and it's tailing away from Wilson. It's going to reach the gap. Cota comes around. And Lawton thinking about three. He's going to give it a try. Relaford's throw will not be in time. A triple from Matt Lawton, make it 4-0 Pirates.
Good low ball hitter, but that ball moving away from it. Lawton just went down and got it, drove it to the deepest part of the ballpark. 410 feet away, and then you see the speed take over for Lawton. Ahead of the throw from Relaford.
And Jack Wilson trying to lay down a bunt.
A lot of times when a pitcher walks, guys, you see a 4-run lead go up on the board, and sometimes your defense gets back on its heels, not expecting a bunt from Wilson.
Two. Yeah, Jennings went through a period last summer, George, where he really struggled, and then he got it together the final 5-6 weeks of the season. He is going through a similar period right now out of the gate. Ground ball up the middle. That'll get through. 5-0. Jack Wilson drives in just his 9th run of the year.
Back to the start that he had against San Diego, at San Diego, 6 runs in 6 innings. The start against Atlanta, 4 innings, 7 runs, but the most of those runs and the damage happened in the second inning.
Jason Bay, the final out, 9 come to bat for Pittsburgh in the second, 5 come around to score. Cota, a 3-run double. Well, the Rockies now have a significant hill to climb in Pittsburgh, down 5-0. Jason Jennings will lead it off in the top of the third against Oliver Perez. Jennings, the only left-handed bat in the Rockies lineup today. And a line drive right at Jack Wilson. On a short hop, he throws over, one out. Well, Perez in the second inning struck out Todd Green on a slider. Then he walked Wilson and Holiday back to back. Dustin Moore was up next. Well, there's the strikeout to Green. And he painted the inside corner to Moore. He also painted the inside corner to Relaford. He struck out the side. Barmas hit the ball hard to left field his first time up. Clint not leading the big leagues at the beginning of play today in hitting. He's second now to Miguel Cabrera. His ability to put the ball in play, I think, will keep him out of any long, pronounced slumps. I mean, right now he's 5 for his last 25 at the plate, but I wouldn't call it a slump.
He's hit balls on the line. He's hit balls right at people. They've made nice plays defensively inside the infield.
That happens in this game.
But as you said, I like it back that because he can run a little bit. I think it'll keep him out of any horrendous slumps. And there's going to be days that his body's going to wear down. It's a different chore at the big league level than the 140 plus games you play at the minor league level.
...94-mile-an-hour heater up and away, and Barmas able to catch up with it. He's got fast hands. Now Guillen now leading the big leagues at Detroit. Cabrera leading the National League is what I should have said. Brian Roberts has had just an outstanding year. Brian Roberts well above his career total in home runs already this season. Luis Gonzalez waits to hit next. He keeps going after him with the fastball.
But I like the at bat that Barmas is having, because you're causing Perez to throw a lot of pitches. And that pitch count could affect the result in the 4th or 5th inning, your second and third time through the lineup. Not quite sure where he came up with that starting point in his delivery.
Barmas continues to waste pitches, all fastballs.
Well, this is where you create a pitch. Say, here you go. It's 0-2. I got 4. I'm going to throw you a sidearm knuckleball. I'm going to throw you a split finger. I'll throw you a changeup. Do something different. Give him a different look.
Cota says fastball away. Well, guess not. That's a slider to get his foot. No, he swung at it. And they record the out at first. So that is strikeout number four for Perez.
Hard biting slider. 0-2 count. I didn't think Burma swung at it. Did you?
I didn't think he did. Evidently, the indication came immediately from Mike DeMuro, because Barmas didn't really hesitate much. He took off.
And you could see DeMuro's hand come up in the top left-hand portion of your screen.
First, I thought it got him on the foot, and I said, boy, that's the fastest sprint on a hit-by-pitch I've ever seen.
Yeah, no kidding.
Two out, nothing cooking for the Rockies. Luis Gonzalez up there. Gonzo hit a pop down the right field line that was caught by the second baseman Castillo. How does Perez look to you? Obviously the results have been outstanding.
The velocity's back. He's flashed 96, consistently 92, 93, hard slider. I think the Rockies have helped by swinging at a couple of pitches out of the strike zone. Dominated the bottom half of the lineup. Right now he seems to struggle to find the strike zone. Get two quick outs as he did. All of a sudden falling behind Gonzalez, 3-1.
By the way, for every home run the Rockies hit during tonight's game and during all 12 La Pura de Plata games in 2005, Coors Brewing Company will donate $500 to Sam Sandoz's Christmas baskets. Third walk of the ball game for Perez. So that is one trend that he has not been able to curtail. Three walks, 2 2/3.
A very emotional kid, a guy that loses focus at times. Start to fall off of pitches, thinks it's too easy, starts to get bored within the game.
Nice to be that talented that you get bored out there.
Who was it the other day they said that to us? When was it with Atlanta? Was it Smoltz?
Yeah, Smoltz. You know, who said that about Smoltz?
I think it was Bobby Cox. Said he gets bored during the games. It's like he's just blowing people away, and all of a sudden he just loses focus for an inning.
One and oh on Garrett Atkins. Four straight multi-hit games for Atkins, and the breaking pitch in there for a strike last night.
A lot of teams have tried to take the ball away from Atkins at times, and before it was jamming him inside. When he started to turn on that pitch, now he goes to the opposite field with that outside fastball.
That was well hit, but it was right at Matt Lawton. Gonzalez left on base, 5-0 Pittsburgh, middle of three. Another great crowd at PNC Park. Last night, more than 31,000 in the house for fireworks. And tonight, filled up again. Oliver Perez and Jason Jennings, and so far big advantage to Oliver Perez. 5-0 Pittsburgh, and the breaking pitch in there for a strike to Darryl Ward, the cleanup hitter, first baseman for Pittsburgh, son of Gary Ward. Drew Goodman along with George Frazier, and this ball is rifled to the gap in right center field, and it's a tweener. Nice job by Moore to lay out, knock the ball down, but it's still a double for Ward. Fifth hit of the ball game for the Pittsburgh Pirates.
Really great hustle by Moore to cut this ball off. Not that Ward has the speed to get to third base, but yet you don't want to give him that opportunity. All down and away from him. Jennings right now is having a difficult time with the Pirates, trying to place pitches inside the strike zone. For somebody that walked a couple, the Pirates pretty anxious to swing the bat, not allowing you to get ahead in the count.
Castillo takes ball one. He had a single his first time up. Came around to score last inning. 317 average now for Jose Castillo. 24-year-old from Venezuela. And on the outside corner, 1-1. Jennings, in his first start at PNC Park a few years ago, it almost turned into one of those real memorable outings. He had a no-hitter with two outs in the seventh inning before he gave up a hit.
You remember the hit? It was a broken bat single over the head of Todd Zeal, because Zeal was playing in to take the bunt away. If he's playing in his normal
third base, he landed on the dirt.
If he's normal position at third base, he's able to catch the soft line.
You're right. Jennings did not throw a complete game that day. The Rockies did have a shutout, though. Back on August 1st of 2002. Jennings has lost his last two starts at PNC Park, but in one of those starts he gave up just one run. Rockies have struggled here, just 5-11. Here's the 2-2. That's way outside, 3-2. Tonight is game number 40, so ostensibly a quarter of the season is history in the 2005 campaign. And if you're going to be accurate in assessing where the Rockies are right now in their process, 12-27, that is what it is. It's not the record they wanted, but the young guys have really performed very, very well. That's inside ball four. When I say young guys, it's not just Barmas. Hop has been outstanding. Sullivan, when given an opportunity, hitting over 300, first career home run last night. Jeff Francis is 4-1 in his rookie year. The only rookie that is struggling is J.D. Closser. The two guys that the Rockies really counted on in their rotation, Joe Kennedy and Jason Jennings, the two guys that were vying for the number one starter role, your two top pitchers, have not performed well.
And I think Kennedy's starting to get it back together again, and this ball hit hard to right field. Moore will give chase.
Moore's going to get there. Darrell Ward will tag and go to third. So a long out off the bat of Mikoviak, first of the inning.
Well, I'd agree with you, and I just think the two guys, although Kennedy has started to throw the ball more consistently than he ever has before, and with Jennings, it seems like muscle memory. Remember the complete ball game that he threw against the Dodgers at home, 9-1 win. He gave up one run on 10 hits and 9 innings. And then since that point, has given up 21 earned runs in his last four starts.
Tyke Redmond walked last inning. First and third situation. Castillo can run. He's at first base. Redmond turns on one. And again, Moore will scramble back, make the catch. Darrell Ward tags. The throw goes to second. It's 6-0 Pittsburgh on the sac fly. Now Redmond's going to get back in the good graces of Lloyd McClendon the way he's swinging the bat.
A good situational hitting by Redmond. Runner third, one out. You know, winning's contagious, Drew, and everybody up and down the lineup will do what they need to do to win a baseball game. So as a manager, you can overlook some things offensively because of the defense and your team's winning. When you start to lose your leadoff man, in Redmond's instance, if he's not doing his job, which Matt Lawton is, the focus becomes much brighter. You start to look for the reasons to make changes on your ball club. And when you're winning and playing sound baseball, one guy can struggle and you can overcome that.
Left center field, look out. Holiday ducks out of the way. Wilson makes the catch. In the inning, another run for Pittsburgh. A lead double by Darrell Ward. He came around. All right, Taco Bell game reset. Close your eyes. Second inning, Pittsburgh bases loaded. Humberto Cota rips a pitch high in the zone down the left field line. It would clear the bases. 3-0 Pittsburgh, but they would add on. Lawton with a triple to the gap. And then Jack Wilson would bring Lawton around with a base hit up the middle. 6-0 as the Rockies come to hit in the top of the fourth inning. Todd Green will lead it off. He's batting in the cleanup spot today. Preston Wilson, ordinarily in that spot, is hitting fifth tonight. And the first pitch from Perez is popped up by Green. Castillo. Affleck trivia question tonight on a Saturday in Pittsburgh, PA. And it reads,
Affleck.
There's the duck, a little bit late. There have been 13 home runs hit into the Allegheny River, including one last night by Matt Lawton, who's the only Rocky to hit one into the Allegheny. And if you're paying attention last night, you would have learned the answer. Two and oh on Wilson. And 3-0 went to a breaking pitch, 2-0 with a 6-0 lead. And a 3-1 hacked at 3-2. Last time the Rockies claimed a series win in Pittsburgh, or against Pittsburgh period, was in 2002. Ball four. A little update on Chinwei Cao, who, after getting a second opinion in Los Angeles on his shoulder, will undergo surgery at the Stedman Hawkins Clinic in Denver on Wednesday. And of course, no date for his return has been determined, and they won't know the full extent of the damage. He appears to have at least a partial tear of his labrum. Whenever you scope, you go in and look at the rotator cuff. Typically, that can be a 10 to 12 month rehabilitation time frame before you can expect to have Sal back. But again, there's no way to determine how long it will take, because you don't know the extent of the damage, and every athlete is different in terms of how quickly they can respond to rehab, et cetera, et cetera. And the shoulder, now George is. We learned to talking to Keith Duggar the other day, the Rockies trainer. This ball's hit well center field, way back. This is going to get out. Home run, Matt Holliday. A two-run shot, his second of the year. More on Sal in a moment. Matt Holliday crushes it, almost a dead center field, and it's 6-2. First hit of the ball game for the Rockies.
And it's a big hit, followed by a walk from Perez to Wilson. Yes, this kid's got some strength now, and he's got opposite field type strength. And when he hit it, I think he knew on this baseball by the sound, the feel, that it was out of the ballpark. If you're a pitcher, that's an ugly sound to hear. That ball was hit deep, 15 rows up into the seats.
Dustin Moore fouls it off. Good to see Holliday knocking the ball out of the yard. Anyhow, to finish on Sal and what we learned from Keith Duggar, the Rockies trainer. Science, the medical profession, has made great strides with fixing damaged elbows. The Tommy John surgery, guys come back, sometimes they even throw harder than they did before the Tommy John.
John Smoltz, great example of that.
Yeah, before the Tommy John surgery. And Dustin Moore, struggling right now, punches out. And the shoulder is still an area that, I guess, it's more of an inexact science in terms of the rehabilitation process.
There's so much pressure put on the elbow through the fastball, the back side of the shoulder, the front part of the elbow, very difficult, or shoulder I should say, difficult to rehab. And doctors will tell you, Well, the rehab should last 6 to 8 months. That's to be normal. That's to get to eat with your right hand. That's to, to get to turn on the water. That's to get it out of the sling. Those are the normal rehab. But to throw a baseball at a major league game, you are not going to get it done. I say realistically, Drew, 12 to 15 months. A lot of guys say 9 to 12, and it depends on the individual, how old the individual is, how much wear and tear has been on the shoulder prior to the injury.
And Sal, to be honest, has a quote-unquote older shoulder than his age would indicate, because in his native land of Taiwan, he threw an enormous amount as a youngster.
Well, you don't know how that throwing was monitored either. And what I mean, pitch counts there as a young kid throwing 130, 140 pitches in a ball game, going in back-to-back days, starting on a Thursday, coming back Saturday. At the younger age, unfortunately, at times when the college level and high school level, winning means everything, and the health of a young pitcher doesn't mean a lot as long as there's a W on the board when it comes to pitch count, days of rest in between. Biggest complaint that pro scouts have is kids that throw on a Thursday in a complete game, come back Saturday on a complete ball game, and relieve on Sunday.
And Relaford on a 3-2 pitch. Foul tip held by Cota. Six strikeout by Perez, but in the inning, the Rockies get their first hit. It's a big one. 6-2 Pittsburgh. If you look closely, George, can you circle it on your telestrator? You see right where here? The American flag
right
is
there? There?
Well, that's right there is where Neil Armstrong left the American flag.
Right,
you see it?
Is that better?
Yeah, there you go.
Right there?
Got to look carefully. Got to have real good vision.
Everybody in the booth looking.
Oliver Perez steps in against Jason Jennings. That scares me a little bit.
Yeah,
because we have the
thing?
Rockies pilots with us.
Well,
and you figured they would know a little something about astronomy. George was not circling, guys, the American flag up there. That telescope, that lens is not quite that powerful.
Yeah, not quite that strong. No, it's not.
Ooh, boy. Now I'm a little concerned. Where are we going tomorrow, Milwaukee?
That way.
Jim?
Where the sun's setting, you go that way.
Yeah.
When you see a city by a lake, you sit down. Then you're there.
It's a good thing there's a highway up there. I'll just follow the road. No, we're blessed. We have three wonderful pilots who
get us home safely every time.
Get us home safely every time, wherever we're traveling. Perez with his first knock of the year through the left side of the infield. He was 0 for 13. Let's check our Budweiser What's on Tap, our television schedule over the next few days on this road trip. Tomorrow, as we always are on Sunday on UPN 20, then Monday and Tuesday pregame show at 5:30 in the Mountain Time Zone on FSN Rocky Mountain, and a day off Wednesday. The Rockies will play no television Thursday noon, high noon from Wrigley Field against the Cubs. In fact, every ball game against the Chicago Cubs will be an afternoon affair. Matt Lawton, a triple to the gap in left center his last time up. Luis Gonzalez, boy, that was strange. You know, we hadn't talked about Gonzo playing first. Gonzo right now playing behind the pitcher Perez, not expecting him to go anywhere. But looking down at first base, seeing a Rockies uniform, and it's not number 17 is weird.
Very difficult to adjust to. Now, Perez, you say not going anywhere. He's a very fleet of foot. But the one thing about him, more than anything else, Drew, is the fact that Perez 3 years ago hurt sliding into first base. So they like to keep him up on his shoes and not trying to do things he's not, does not have the ability to do. That's one of those who's run the bases. It's Todd Helton with a night off, has not left the dugout.
That is the fourth walk.
Jennings has been a little frustrated with the strike zone from Mike DeMuro all night long. Now all of a sudden Bob Apodaca is starting to give an earful to Mike DeMuro. All good pitching coaches will do. They'll back up your pitcher in a hurry.
Yeah, Blaine Neal starting to throw for the Rockies in their bullpen. Jack Wilson, an RBI single his last time up. And he lays down a bunt. Jennings will have one play at first, and it'll work as a sacrifice. Second and third, one out for Jason Bay. Bay has been quiet so far in this series, 0 for 7. And Jennings gets that one in there, strike one. .21 starts in left field for Jason Bay, 19 starts in center field this season. He has not missed a ball game. And that ball tails over the outside corner, quickly 0-2. Well, here's something interesting. Jason Bay, we talked about this last night, the first Pittsburgh Pirate in their storied history to be named Rookie of the Year. But how about this? Rookies of the Year, Major League Baseball, NFL, same city. Roethlisberger, the quarterback for the Steelers, named Rookie of the Year. Happened in L.A. with the Bettis and Piazza. Happened a couple times in L.A. Fouled off. Let's go back to that graphic, check it out again. In 1981, current pitching coach for the Giants, former teammate of my partner George Frazier, with the Yankees, Dave Rigetti, when LT was the story of the NFL with the Giants. And then you go back to the early 60s in Chicago at 56, Luis Aparicio. Not to be honest, I don't remember J.C. Caroline.
Well, I was just trying to figure out if I ever.
I remember Ditka.
Yeah, Ditka was pretty good.
No, so you got to say it right. Ditka.
Okay. Well, Fuji and King Supers is having photo day, whether you knew it or not. They're doing it on June 4th from 3:30 to 4:30. Bring your camera, take pictures of your favorite Rockies players. Entrance to the event will be at gates A and D. The Reds are in town, 6:05 start. Tickets available at the Coors Field ticket office, the Rockies dugout and King Superstores. Call 1-800-388-ROCK or go online with the Colorado Rockies.com.
Darrell Ward, 1-for-2, a double. And he fouls it off. One out, runners at two outs, runners at second and third. Perez at third. Matt Lawton at second base. 6-2 Pittsburgh. They led 6-0. Matt Holliday last inning at a two-run home run. Colorado has been out hitting the contest 6-1. And this ball is hit a long way foul.
Are the boats still out there? Oh, I didn't get out of here. We had all the boats are still parked. Not quite like McCovey's Cove in San Francisco, though, is it?
Well, see,
when Barry's active,
I should say. But no, I mean, it's crowded with boats and kayakers, and swimmers, skinny dippers, and all sorts of folks. You haven't looked carefully, have you?
I missed that part.
And again, it's hammered foul.
You know, he probably had enough.
That one may end up in the Allegheny.
Did it? Or is it in the guy's boat?
Oh, you got it. I got it. It was headed for the guy's boat. He's just walking along.
Foul ball, though, so just throw it out in the water. Go ahead, throw it to him. Come on, throw it to him.
Who wants it?
Come on, throw it out in the river. This is when I caught a home run ball. And then he found out it's foul, and he throws it in the river.
Blocked by Green.
John Russell, third base coach for the Pirates, talking to Perez. Perez getting a Lancey at third base on that ball out in front of Green. John Russell's name being mentioned right now at the University of Oklahoma for their head baseball coach's position. Not sure he'd leave this job, though.
High in the air and playable for Dustin Moore. And that is all for Pittsburgh in the fourth. They'll leave two on, 6-2, as we move on to inning number five, just off the Allegheny River. Need some transportation. There's a big old taxi working its way down the Allegheny. 6-2. Our score. Drew Goodman with George Frazier. Here comes the duck again to provide us with an answer to our Affleck trivia question. Who's the only Rocky to hit a home run into the Allegheny? Well, think about it. It's got to be a lefty. Walker would be a candidate, but that guy is the right answer. Taking his first night off of the season. And he won't have another night off till maybe he'll get one more before the All-Star break. Todd, one of 13, actually one of 12 hitters to hit the ball into the river. Jason Jennings takes a strike from Perez.
What pitcher in the National League, Drew, do you think is a good enough athlete and hitter that if something happened pitching wise, and the only reason I bring this up, Rick Ankiel with the Cardinals is now playing in Double A and playing the outfield, little first base.
I've got an answer.
He's really struggled. I know you're going to say Mike Hampton.
Well, it is. It's Mike Hampton. Are you going to say the only guy who maybe could turn around
just
and be in position
to
play in the
big
leagues?
Guy that could turn it around and in time, maybe a year in the minor leagues, learning the position, the outfield, or whatever it may be, and be able to hit for a decent average in the big league.
It would have to be Hampton in my book for a couple of reasons. One, first of all, everybody knows he's a terrific hitter by pitcher standards. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean he's a great hitter yet by an everyday standard. But here's what Mike Hampton brings to the table and why I say he would be the likely candidate. He has outstanding speed. He's one of the faster guys in baseball. And he's a tremendous athlete. So you couple that with his ability to swing the bat, and then you season him up in the minor leagues, he to me would be the most likely guy to have a chance if his arm all of a sudden failed him.
That last look, Ankiel was hitting around 210. Really struggled with the bat, a lot of strikeouts, and did have a home run.
Three straight strikeouts for Oliver Perez. He has seven in the game, one out in the fifth inning.
How about Zambrano? What's he doing up there? Mike Hampton, legit 333. Clemens, John Thompson, teammate. Woody Williams is a guy that can handle the bat a little bit with the San Diego Padres.
You know, the guy who just struck out can also swing the bat, as we know. Jason Jennings is 242 average coming in. Highest of any, actually 249 lifetime average, the highest of any active pitcher.
What's Hampton's lifetime average, I wonder?
I'm guessing, and I think it's somewhere in the 230s.
Which is outstanding.
I mean, again, George, as you know, especially from a relief pitcher standpoint, they're not focused on that. They don't get the swings near the number of swings that a position player gets.
No, only in spring training when you're working on the hitting, and that's typically off of a machine.
Meadows getting loose a little bit, 0-2 on Barmas.
You saw Meadows warming up down in their bullpen. This will be pitch 87 for Mr. Perez.
That was a nasty slider in the dirt.
Yep, that's just outstanding. When you watch how he gets you into the hole with the fastball at 95, 96, and he puts the big bend to it. And when you're behind in the count trying to face Oliver Perez, it's just not a good position to be in. Watch this ball bite late and out front, but it's the late break on the baseball that prevents a hitter from being able to lay off of it or make contact.
Ball one on Luis Gonzalez, 0-for-1 and a walk in the game. The only blemish tonight against Oliver Perez, a two-run home run off the bat of Matt Holliday last inning. And the only other negative would be the fact that he's walked four, but he has struck out eight. This ball, center field dying, and it'll drop in front of Matt Lawton, second hit. Tyke Redmond,
well,
I should say.
Take a look at these numbers. This is what I was talking about on Perez. Look at the difference. When he's ahead in the count, a 209 average behind an account 481. You'll see a drastic difference with about every pitcher out there, but that's pretty remarkable there. 272 points away from each other.
Atkins has hit it in the air twice, once to center, once to right. Perez has grown up a little bit, George, because when he came up with the Padres in 2002, mm-hmm. I don't think he shaved.
Well, he had a summer beard, some over here, some over there.
Yeah. Last year, Oliver Perez struck out 239, the third best season for strikeouts in Pirate history. Bob Veal, the former outstanding left-hander in the mid-60s, struck out 276 one year, 250 another year. In fact, Veal has four of the top five strikeout performances in the course of a year in Pittsburgh history. And Atkins waves at that, two balls and two strikes.
Who's John Candelaria on that list?
He did not
make it.
Veal all over the list. Larry McWilliams on the list, Mark Baldwin, Burt Blylevin, your old teammate, Bob mm-hmm. Friend, and wow. Chris Benson, who beat the Yankees today for the Mets in 2000, struck out 184. That's the eighth best. Atkins fouls it off. Strikeouts per nine innings. Last year, Perez struck out 11 per nine. That was the best in baseball last year. Better than Randy Johnson, better than Johan Santana, better than Jason Schmidt. Frame by Cota, but it's down low, 3-2.
You know, I think the one thing they have fought with Perez on the follow through of his delivery, I mentioned earlier in the telecast about the left arm coming across the waist area versus out over that front leg, is that the follow through is so violent and that he falls off so much to the first third base side that at some point he's going to have arm problems with the front shoulder because of the strain that he puts on it.
In the air, shallow center field. Redmond coming on. We'll get there. And that's all for the Rockies in the top of the fifth inning. Gonzalez left the board after singling six. Colorado Rockies baseball on FSN is brought to you by Chrysler. Inspiration comes standard. And by Bank One, home of maximum strength checking. Oh, there's some baseball cards you want to have. Don Clendenin. Great Jackie Robinson, his number of course retired in every ballpark. Chuck Tanner's in the house.
Can I tell a story about Tanner?
Absolutely.
Wonderful. He used to own racehorses. Came into Chicago one day and he says, "All right, guys, my horse is running tomorrow, Hawaii 5-0. Bet the house." Zimmer and I run down to the Don Zimmer, former Rocky coach. We go to the off-track betting, dead last. Bet $100 to win on a horse.
Kind of like Giacomo today.
So we see him about a month later and he says, "Hey, Hawaii 5-0's running today." And I said, "Get out of here." And he said, "He's running today." Zimmer and I go bet 100. "What do you think?" "Dead last." So we don't see him for about a month and a half when we get a phone call in the locker room. "Hey, Hawaii 5-0's running today." "I don't care. I'm hanging a phone up." Wire to wire, he calls and said, "Did you get it?" "Chuck, you already got me twice. You think I'm going to go back in for a third?"
It's a good pickup right there on the short hop by Atkins to throw out Castillo.
I figure when the owner calls you, the horse, and it's Chuck Tanner, you pay attention. Very good manager. I don't think he got a lot of credit for what he did to hold that group together in 1979.
The We Are Family.
You bet. We Are Family group. Dave Parker, Willie Stargell, Bill Madlock, Manny Sanguian.
Think about
late great Willie Stargell.
Yeah, the late great Willie Stargell. And George, you could better describe this because you had to face those guys. How about that lineup? You talk about three great, not good, three great hitters. This ball rifled down the right field line by Mikowiak. He'll have a double. Moore will fire it back in.
You know, what?
You had Stargell, a Hall of Famer. You had Parker, who hit for a high average and great power, and Madlock, who would win batting titles.
Well, don't forget to throw in Phil Garner. Hit 270, was a catalyst at the top. Omar Marino set the table on top. They had that horrible, horrible astroturf at Three Rivers. It just stunk. I mean, it was like playing on cement. He just slap and run. You had no chance to get him out. They were just a great ball club, in a ball club that believed in themselves. It was funny to walk into their locker room, Drew, because they took it upon themselves to make fun of each other to produce wins. And they really rode each other an awful lot. Willie Stargell was the catalyst, and Willie Stargell was the leader of that locker room. Every single player, Kent to Colvey, all the way down to the Candyman, to Burt Blyleven, they all respected Willie, what he said, how he acted. And there was a special the other day. It was really nice to see and see all the guys talking. And every single guy, from Ed Ott all the way up to Colvey, to Blyleven, they all pointed a finger at Willie Stargell.
Well, I know you befriended Willie at one point in your career, and you were telling me a story, George, that bears repeating, that, you know, guys in batting practice don't wear helmets, but they'll wear their baseball cap. Uh-huh. Sometimes they won't have a cap on at all. You know, most of the time there aren't many fans in the ballpark at that time. Willie wore a hat. It wasn't a helmet, it wasn't a baseball hat.
It was a cowboy hat, and it said Charlie One Horse, made by Charlie One Horse out of Houston, Texas. So one day I went and stole his hat. So then when they were coming off the field, I'm walking on the field and I'm waving at him with his straw hat on. He was born in Oklahoma, so he felt he had a connection to each other.
Redmond turns on one. This plays ping pong with the scoreboard. Scoring easily is Mikowiak, back-to-back doubles. And it's 7-2 Pirates.
The long and the short of the story was Willie wanted his hat back, and 2 weeks later I had a brand new straw cap and a felt hat in my locker delivered by Willie Stargell. Still have them in the closet at home. Fastball up out over the plate, right field, off of the scoreboard. Just missed getting out of this yard by about 3 feet. Played brilliantly by Moore and back in, but not in time before you could keep Redmond. And then a second, see Jamie Quirk, Bob Apodaca, they're calling down to the bullpen to see if Mr. Neal's ready to go out of their bullpen. Buying a little time now if you're Todd Green. Here's Neal.
Well, you know, in other starts for Jason Jennings, the problem has been command, where he's walked people. He's walked some people tonight, four walks obviously, too many. But they've hit him hard, George. This, in fact, is the hardest I've at least can remember Jason being hit this year.
Well, you
certainly
look,
one of the
look on the
two
board
toughest outings in terms of guys hitting them hard.
Seven runs given up by Jennings, eight hits of those five of those eight hits have been hit extremely hard for extra base hits. Not a very friendly conversation right now with Jamie Quirk going on, kind of one-sided.
Jamie
may have left out of that dugout thinking he was going to make a switch and decided, you know what, not going to do it. I'm going to make this kid battle through this.
Yeah, Jamie's one of the more mild-mannered people you will meet. One of the nicest
until he gets a
gentlemen.
Uniform on.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, he's a competitor. And that was a one-way conversation.
Well, and realistically, you go out and challenge Jason Jennings, not in a manager's office, not in the bullpen in between starts, but right in the middle of the ball game. And I like the move by Jamie Quirk.
Jamie, of course, has managerial aspirations, and well, he should. Cota, one for two, a three-run double, and he knocks it up the middle. Redmond around third. Wilson not going to throw to the plate. Redmond flying around the bases. It's 8-2 Pittsburgh.
Jamie,
four RBIs for Cota. He had only six coming in.
And Jamie not happy right now with the end result of this. Another base hit given up. 10 RBIs now for Cota.
So that'll be all for Jason Jennings. He goes 4 1/3, and he gives up 8 runs. 8-2 Pittsburgh. Cota, a career high 4 RBIs at first base with one out. The new pitcher is Blaine Neal, making just his 3rd appearance since the Rockies picked him up.
Hey, see, again, it's going to be time for him to get his arm in shape, feel comfortable back on the mound, used to working in a lot of ball games.
Ty Wigginton is the pinch hitter. Oliver Perez is done after innings. Wigginton, a starter at third base after he was picked up last year, struggled in a Pirate uniform. Right now, he's been watching Mikowiak play third the last couple of ball games.
Well, when things start to go south again, when you're on the hill trying to figure it out, is one of the most difficult things for a young pitcher to do. And particularly when you have had that success, you keep telling yourself it's going to turn the corner. The next start's going to be that start. Ball driven deep and where you can't catch it if you're Dustin Moore. And I think that's something that young pitchers, even though you've been in the big leagues a couple of years, when you do start to have struggle, it's difficult to gain that confidence back. You think you turn the corner and then all of a sudden the next ball game and it changes for you and it's harder to get back. And boy, you're only left with your own thoughts of trying to figure out what you were doing wrong. You try to replay it in your mind.
Runner goes and it's fouled off. I think, and this has been discussed many times in the past, the most frustrating thing for a starting pitcher when things are not going well is that he has to sit and stew for 4 days in between starts.
You know, a lot of times, and again, it's food for thought, it goes into that category, is it? That if they're not that stiff or too stiff, they throw the hitters in between starts to try to get into some type of a groove where you see it, where you try to not only just throw in a side to a bullpen, but you throw to hitters.
What pitching coach used to do that, George?
Art Fowler with the New York Yankees did it. Whitey Herzog would have you do it, particularly the long men in the bullpen. If you knew you had, you know, Bob Force, Ron Guidry, or today if you had a pitcher going out that you knew that was going to go 5 or 6, you weren't going to use your long man in the bullpen. Have you throw in between starts on the side, but of course it also depends.
Gonzalez down the right field line, right near the stands.
Nice play.
Makes a very nice play. Not surprising.
But a lot of guys just do not are comfortable doing it because of the stiffness of the body. And one more look here at Gonzalez going over, not even paying attention where the wall is, knows the ballpark, tracks the baseball, makes the catch. Pretty good athlete.
You can play him anywhere. You go put the gear on him right
now. I wonder if he's the third catcher that Clint had never told us about.
Well, I know there's one guy who's not, who you think maybe would be a candidate, Desi Relaford, who could play everywhere.
Yeah, he's not
pitched an inning in the big leagues. I asked him the other day, I said, are you the emergency guy? He said, I'm not going back there. That's one spot I'm not going to. 8-2 Pittsburgh after they defeated the Rockies 9-4 last night. With George Frazier, I'm Drew Goodman. We go to the top of the 6th inning at PNC Park in Pittsburgh. Brian Meadows, who pitched to one batter in last night's ball game, he caught Matt Holliday looking. On for the 15th time this year, relief of Oliver Perez.
And Perez pretty good. 5 innings, 2 hits, 2 runs, 4 walks, 8 strikeouts. If he can hang on, he'll run his record to 4-2 versus the Rockies. If the bullpen can do their job, and 3-0 in his last 3 starts versus the Rockies.
Well, I think if you're Lloyd McClendon, you're very pleased with the results tonight from Oliver Perez after being taken out of the rotation the last couple of turns.
No question, because now you've proven to him you're going to throw strikes. You had that explosive slider to work yourself out of any type of situations, as he did a couple of times in this ball game.
And he kept the same arm slot.
Well, he did. I mean, the only thing I would look at is his follow through, and as violent as it is, to try to get him more focused to the plate. He has the same type of delivery in a much smaller form that as Randy Johnson had young in his career, where he would fly off the third base side, the arm would drag, it would change direction, the ball wouldn't be in the strike zone.
Two and 0 on Todd Green, 0 for 2 against Oliver Perez. And on the outside corner, that's a strike. High foul ball. You know, there's so much that has been written about this great game over the years. Many articles, libraries full of books by some of the greatest authors in this country over the last century plus. I'll tell you one of my favorite lines from a famous author. It's a poster hanging in the press box. Roger Angel from the interior stadium once wrote, "Since baseball time is measured only in outs, all you have to do is succeed utterly. Keep hitting, keep the rally alive, and you have defeated time. You remain forever young." And it's the essential part of baseball that makes it different from the other major sports. There is no clock involved. And if you keep that rally alive, you always have a chance. No one will step forward and say the horn just sounded. And on cue, we have a horn in the background. Do you like how I timed that out?
Yeah, that was perfect.
Wilson, 2 walks in the ball game, and Meadows gets a hook over, and it's 0-2. Isn't that a marvelous line, though, from Roger Angel?
Yes, it is.
And a nasty slider. Wilson has got 2 outs in the 6th. Well, a bright spot tonight has been Matt Holliday. A sonic good replay of the ball game. Matt Holliday, he knew it was gone. Deep to center field, a 2-run shot. Unfortunately, the only 2 runs for Colorado. Slowly hit at Jack Wilson, and he gets it over in time to Darrell Ward. 1-2-3. We move along to the bottom of the 6th inning in Pittsburgh. The scoreboard reads the Pirates 8, the Rockies 2. And the Pirates will have Jack Wilson, Jason Bay, and Darrell Ward, 2, 3, and 4 in their lineup to face Blaine Neal, who got the final 2 outs of the 5th inning. 1 for 2 and a sacrifice for Jack Wilson. He has the average over 200, which is a far cry from where he was last year, 308. Matt Holliday retreats in left center field.
One of the ways that they have tried to approach it with Jack Wilson, not to put him in this category yet of Derek Jeter, but Jeter hit a .150 the month of April, part of May, and finished over 300. So what they're trying to point out to him is stay to the grind. Don't try to change your delivery, your approach to the plate. Continue your swing, continue your hard work. Don't give up. You're a young player, an all-star. You know you can do it. You just got to believe you can do it.
You know, one thing that seasoned players at this level remember, and that is that there's a whole lot of games. It may be May 21st, and from Jack Wilson's perspective, he looks at his average and he says, oh, it's around 200. Well, he's got another 120 plus games to get that straightened out. Gerald Perry, the hitting coach, knows that. Longtime big leaguer. 2 balls and a strike. And from a Rockies perspective, Jason Jennings has three quarters of a season to produce wins and get himself back on track.
You know what, you roll off eight or nine in a row and all of a sudden you're 9-6 and you go, I don't remember being 1-5. I mean, you don't remember those things. All of a sudden, all you remember is the good, and that's, you know, it's amazing when you evaluate talent as a scout, general manager, manager, coaches. Everybody always looks for what you can't do. Well, he can't do this, he can't do that, but boy, he can do this. Well, he really can't do that. To find reasons for you not to be successful as a player, at times you have to find reasons to show why you are successful.
This pick up by Atkins, showing range to his left. Boy, his confidence growing defensively each day.
That's all about reaction, flexibility, and timing. That's exactly what he does. Caught the ball on the correct hop. But see, he gathered himself in front of that point to front shoulder. Stay right behind the baseball on the follow through and delivery.
Jamie Quirk was saying before the ball game, one of the reasons he has improved so much is his relationship with the Rockies infield instructor and third base coach Mike Gallego. He says Mike works with him all the time. He trusts Mike. He likes working with him. And he is, George, it's not even the same guy defensively that we saw a couple of years ago. Good pitch by Neal, slow roller at Desi Relliford. And Neal has retired five straight since coming into the ball game for Jennings. Coors Light game reset in the fourth inning. The Rockies trailed 6-0. And they would get back in it, at least momentarily, when Matt Holliday hit a long ball with a man aboard off Oliver Perez. But back came the offense for Pittsburgh. Mikowiak a double, Tyke Redmond right behind him with the double. And then Humberto Cota, who's had a huge day offensively, drives in Redmond with his fourth RBI. Dustin Moore is being removed for a pinch hitter. And it will be Pittsburgh native Corey Sullivan against Brian Meadows. And what an evening last night for Corey Sullivan, pinch hitting late in the ball game. Deep right center field and gone. First career home run for Sullivan. It comes in his hometown in front of a ton of friends last night. He went to North Allegheny High School, about a 15-minute drive from downtown, and then on to Wake Forest University. So what a great moment individually, Sullivan's first career home run. And look at this one. He tags this one to fairly deep right field. And on the warning track, Lawton hauls it in. Let's take a look at our Charles Schwab player profile on Desi Relliford.
Born in Valdosta, Georgia, raised in Jacksonville, Florida. Favorite cartoon growing up would probably be Dungeons and Dragons. It's a lot of people don't know about that one.
Yeah, Desi's an interesting guy. And he takes strike one from Brian Meadows. Has his own record label. Been well traveled in his baseball career, but he says he's enjoyed it because he's met a lot of people and enjoyed each new city that he's called home. Brad Hoff has come out on deck for Blaine Neal.
Neal quietly worked very well for inning and two thirds for the Rockies.
Did a good job.
You bet.
One more note on that home run last night by Sullivan in the pinch. It was the Rockies' first pinch hit home run of the year. Graybo, the left-hander. Rockies saw him last night. Some other scores, interleague play. This is the only matchup in baseball not involved in interleague play. White Sox over the Cubs earlier today, 5-3. The Angels beat the Dodgers 3-1 today. Florida over Tampa Bay 4-3. The Mets beat the Yankees 7-1. And Texas. Sure, this wasn't a Cowboy Oiler score from years gone by. 18-3. The Rangers over the Astros. And a sliding catch by Jason Bay. Seventh inning, Cleveland leading in Cincinnati 5-3.
Yeah, that's one of the most difficult things for an outfielder, to either dive head first or put a slide on to go get this baseball. And just a nice catch by Jason Bay in left field.
San Francisco in the third inning leading Oakland 3-1. Jamie Quirk making an adjustment to add Hop, pinch hitting for Neal. Detroit and Arizona tied at 1 in the sixth. That's a ball. Seattle, San Diego later on. Kansas City in the seventh leading St. Louis 5-3. Milwaukee leading Minnesota right now 4-0. Atlanta leading Boston 3-0 in the fifth inning at Fenway. Toronto beat Washington 7-0 earlier. So Toronto's won the first two ball games of that series. That's in their first strike. Baltimore in the sixth leading Philadelphia 2-0. I know Frank Robinson was trying to downplay the Nationals or the Expos, aka the Nationals, going to Toronto and playing in Canada. And he said that he hopes that the main rivalry when interleague play comes up in late May and June each year becomes the Baltimore Orioles. And that's certainly the natural rivalry now for Washington.
It should be. Kind of like the Mets Yankees, you take a bus over, play the ball game.
Yep.
Bus back and alternate it every day. Well, Hop, I didn't think the first pitch called a strike was a strike, nor do I think that. You can see the jerk. Now watch the jerk right here. Watch him pull it back down. Now let it roll a little bit. See him pull that back down to the strike zone, almost 6 to 8 inches.
Hop drives it down the left field line, same spot that last fastball was. Foul. Hop had a sack fly for an RBI last night. Third currently in hitting on the Rockies at 320. Strike three on the outside corner. And I think Brad knew it. A 1-2-3 inning for Meadows. He retired all six of the two innings he pitched. There's Corey Sullivan in right field for Dustin Moore after pinch hitting as we go to the bottom of the seventh inning. And we have a new pitcher for the Rockies. It's David Cortez.
Yeah, been a while since he worked in a ball game. Tough to control it here. It's the hardest thing, a guy in a bullpen, when you don't work consistently. Being 3 to 4 days a week, sometimes you lose focus. It's difficult to throw strikes. It's so important that when you do your side work in the bullpen, you try to make it as much of a game simulation as you can. First offering, 93 mile an hour cheese.
Well, you're always being evaluated when you're a young player. In the case of Cortez, he's not necessarily young, but he hasn't had much experience in the big leagues.
Now, just three ball games for the Rockies. Four innings pitched, a couple of strikeouts, the opposition, right-handed batters, I should say. A 143 average versus Cortez. Most of his damage at higher run average came in one ball game.
Good spot there. Boy, you live there, you're not going to give up a lot of runs.
No, and I tell you, the hardest thing is the breaking ball, because you have a tendency, the adrenaline that you've got flying, the emotions of getting back in a ball game, you have a tendency to rush your delivery. And you fall under the slider and twirl it versus staying on top of it. Pretty good heat right there at 94. He's topped out at 95.
He was very good in the spring. In fact, had the Rockies not acquired Young Kim at the end of spring training, Cortez, in all likelihood, would have broke camp and headed north. Right field and deep. Sullivan looking up, will have to play it off the wall. Castillo digging a second, and he'll have a double. You know, Pittsburgh has played pepper with that right field wall, the scoreboard area, all evening.
And this is a club that hasn't hit well with runners in scoring position all year. They hit around 230 last in the National League a year ago, 220. Leadoff men had struggled in every inning for them, but not tonight. They've swung the bats extremely well. How about the throw by Sullivan? You know, a guy that had surgery just a year ago. He's got a good hose.
He really does. He's got a right field arm. And he could play all three outfield spots. Mikoviak up there, he doubled, short hopping the right field wall his last time up. 1-for-2 for Mikoviak and a walk in the ball game. He scored a couple of runs.
If you haven't signed up yet, you need to. Sunday, May 22nd, for the Rockies home run. Run, walk, run. It's enjoy a 5K run and walk ending with a lap around the warning track at Coors Field. The dugout store, specialty runner stores for brochures or online with the ColoradoRockies.com. Runners will receive a t-shirt, post-event party, and two free tickets to a future Rockies game. 303 Rockies for more information.
Heater, 1-2. Remember, we were talking last night about Mikoviak, how rare it is that he's a third baseman who also plays center field.
Do you ask him today, could he think of another one?
I didn't ask Rob today. I may ask him tomorrow, but I did ask another baseball historian.
Who?
Tracy Ringlesby.
And
he couldn't think of anybody. Then we started talking about third baseman that could run. And he mentioned a guy he watched a lot, George Brett.
Pete Rose could run a little bit.
Yeah, but I mean, Pete played everywhere. Right?
Yeah,
I mean,
he played solid years at third base too, though.
That's fair. A guy that finished his career with the Rockies, Hojo, Howard Johnson could run. He was a 30-30 guy.
Mike Schmidt ran well early
in his career, you bet. Strike three, good pitch by Cortez. Mikoviak is done. First out in the seventh.
Well, left-handed hitter up, right-handed pitcher. You see a lot of balls to the outside part of the plate, and it just freezes him with a little bit of an off-speed pitch on that inside half. See that ball cut late into the glove of Todd Green. He gets the strikeout.
That'll do enough to change the bat speed, George. When you can throw 93, 94, touch 95 like Cortez. It's something off-speed. That wasn't a great slider, but there was enough taken off that it fooled the hitter.
Locked him up.
Tyke Redmond, 1-for-1 officially. A couple of RBIs. He had a sack fly. He scored a couple runs. Also a walk. 5 for his last 5 against the Rockies in this series. Cortez took a little something off that fastball and got it in the pitching vernacular on the arm side.
Well, a lot of times what you see guys do, they'll take off of it and sink the baseball, which will reduce velocity, versus a four-seam fastball where you can increase velocity.
1-1. That's down a little bit. 2-1 on Redmond. Rockies shorten up their outfield. Runner at second base, Castillo, 8-2 Pittsburgh. On the ground toward the hole, Relaford dives. He won't have a play. Redmond, 6-for-6 in this series. That'll help the old average.
You better believe it will. Started today at 208. Started the series at 167. This ball over into the gap. Does he a nice play to knock this ball down, try to regain his balance to get the throw off to Gonzalez. Just couldn't happen. Did prevent the run.
Cota's got a chance to add to his career high in RBIs. He's got 4 in the ball game, 2-for-3. Bases loaded double in the second inning. Played it 3 runs. This is a comebacker. Cortez goes to second on the first double play. And that is all for Pittsburgh. So a nice job by Cortez. He fired a strike to the shortstop Varmus, who turned it over. 2 hits in the inning. A man left, 8-2, as we move on to inning number 8 in Pittsburgh. Not AG. 8th inning. That looks like a postcard. It's so pretty. Across the Allegheny River, downtown Pittsburgh. And the Pirates pleasing the home folks right now. They lead 8-2. Top of the order for the Rockies against Solomon Torres, who also appeared in the ballgame last night for the Pirates. Gave up a run in the 9th inning against Colorado. Oliver Perez started the ballgame, went 5 innings. He struck out 8, walked 4, gave up just 2 hits. One of the hits, a 2-run home run by Matt Holliday. So Perez trying to get back on track and seemingly did so this evening. Varmus looking for his first hit tonight. It's 0-for-3, and he won't get it here. Jack Wilson will throw him out. Seventeenth appearance for Torres. Solid ERA. Very good
right
against
righties,
not so good against lefties.
That was 8 walks, something just out of the bullpen. Boy, it's tough to deal with.
I got something that may surprise you, Mr. Frazier. How about this? The Pittsburgh Pirates, since May 3rd, their pitching staff has an ERA of 2.91. That is the best in baseball.
All right, now I want to ask you a question.
Yeah.
How many runs have they averaged per start over that span?
Not enough, because their record's above 500, but it should be dramatically above 500, and it's not. They are 14-10 their last 24 ball games. Obviously have a great chance to be 15-10. Gonzalez walks with 1 out. That'll bring Atkins up. Tough start to the season, 4-11. Tough start at home. They're now 6-12 at home. You know, a year ago they started 4-13 at PNC Park. They eventually finished 72-89. 12 straight losing seasons for the Pirates. And the next place the Rockies will go, Milwaukee. The Brewers have also had 12 straight losing campaigns. Atkins, two flyouts to center field, 1 to right field. Came in hitting 462 over his previous 8 ball games, including 4 home runs. K Dakota's been barking at Torres in Spanish after each of the last two pitches. And I guarantee it, it has something to do with throw strikes. You're up six runs. And he's now walked Atkins after walking Gonzalez.
Well, a lot of times when you have a guy like Cota behind the plate, a veteran guy, knows what he's doing. You go out and visit a little bit with him, try to challenge him to throw strikes. Spin Williams is going to hustle out to the mound in a hurry.
I think more than any manager in baseball, Lloyd McClendon will come out to the mound to talk to his pitcher, not to take him out. Lloyd will deliver the message himself many times.
Well, another guy would do the same thing. Tony Pena in Kansas City for you, resent.
Hey, tune in Sunday at 10 p.m. for Rockies Weekly. Go beyond the diamond for an exclusive look into Major League life with the Rockies. Join hosts Keith Flyer and Darian Boyle for an inside look at the team. That's Rockies Weekly Sunday at 10 p.m. Todd Green steps up. He tried to get a breaking pitch over and he could not. It's 1-0. Green has started 18 games coming into tonight behind the plate. He has a hit in 16 of those ball games. And even 300. 0-for-3 tonight. And that's at the knees. 1-1. An awfully nice average with runners in scoring position. 474.
Well, and a lot of those hits with runners in scoring position has put the Rockies on top or tied the ballgame. Think of Atlanta, the eighth inning hit tied it, ninth inning hit won it. Not even close.
Well, I guarantee you, Lloyd McClendon's not going to mess around with Solomon Torres and his control problems.
Not at all. And this fastball doesn't even, I mean, it's not even close. This ball's not 4 feet, 5 feet out of the strike zone.
Maybe six.
Six and a half. It wasn't a strike, nor is that one.
He's now walked the bases loaded. And the crowd's getting antsy. Lloyd saying to spin. What'd you say to him?
Whatever you said, I don't like it. It's not working. Lloyd said, well, we just make a double switch and get you out of the ball game. Third of an inning for Torres, three walks.
We'll tell you about the changes when we come back. Pittsburgh leads it 8-2. The Rockies had the bases loaded, one out in the eighth. David Ross, who started last night, has come on to catch in the double switch. And the new pitcher is another guy the Rockies saw last night, Rick White.
Former Rocky. Coming into the ball game, 17th appearance for White.
In fact, Sullivan hit his home run off White last night.
11 strikeouts in 18 innings and 11 games in April. 525. He's pitched very effective in the month of May. 1-0, 150.
Bases loaded, all on walks. Gonzalez, Atkins, and Green. Davey Collins, the first base coach. You know, tomorrow we mentioned that with Clint Hurdle back with his family in Denver, and Jamie Quirk going to his son's graduation in Kansas City, the ball club will be run by both Dwayne Espy and Bob Apodaca. One of the things that the Rockies toyed with was having Mike Gallego come in and be the bench coach, Collins go and be the third base coach, but they felt like they'd have too many people moving around. And so they settled on Espy and Apodaca in tandem. And again, Espy has managed in professional baseball and done a good job. Preston Wilson with the bases loaded, big swing and a miss.
246, four home runs, 21 RBIs for Preston. A couple of walks in this ball game, scored a run.
He's come up with a bases juice quite a few times this year. At least it seems that way. High in the air to right field. Should get a run home. Lawton makes the catch. And Luis Gonzalez will come home with the Rockies' third run on the sac fly by Wilson. Two outs. Matt Holliday will come up. Atkins home run earlier, second. He has 20 ribbies now. Holiday, I mean.
Hey, by the way, June 7th, the Chicago White Sox will be in the Mile High City. First 15,000 through the gates at Coors receives a lapel pin courtesy of King Soopers. That's the second pin in a series of four. White Sox 705 lapel pins courtesy of King Soopers.
Slowly hit Mikowiak. Safe at first. A leg hit for Holiday.
Hey, take the hits any way you can get them. A lot of guys on a ball hit like this. See the courtesy run up the line. Yeah, good exchange by Mikowiak, just good speed by Holiday. Look again, you know, Holiday's thinking, I've got one. Let me meet up some real estate and get the sign to the umpire. I'm safe. DeMuro didn't agree with him last night on a similar call. Lloyd says, see you later.
We'll step aside again. Sullivan will hit. Well, Corey Sullivan has been called back with the left-hander Mike Gonzalez throwing. Aaron Miles will be the pinch hitter. Aaron, one of two right-handed bats available on the bench, the other being another switch hitter, J.D. Closser. Bases loaded, two outs. You never know. It's 8-3. Sullivan's actually done a good job against left-handed pitching and limited experience at the big league level, 5-for-13. And Gonzalez has been outstanding this year out of the pen for Lloyd McClendon.
Yeah, tremendous, 18 strikeouts in 16 innings, 10 straight scoreless appearances.
And a swing and a miss.
93 mile an hour cheese. Wow.
Line drive, deep right field, going back, still going back and making the catches, Lawton. Well, Miles hit it hard, but it's a long out. Rockies did come up with a run.
Rocky Mountain.
8-3 Pittsburgh. We go to the bottom of the eighth inning. And a couple of changes for Colorado. Desi Relaford becomes the new right fielder. Aaron Miles steps into the ball game and will play second base. Relaford was at second base. The Rockies have had three right fielders in the game. Four, Sullivan, and now Relaford. Marcus Carvajal, who pitched last night, on to throw the bottom of the eighth here.
Right hander with a very fine earned run average, 15 and a third. The opponent average at a buck 85, including 133. Right-handed hitters have really struggled.
Yeah, Leading off for the Pirates will be David Ross. He came on in the double switch, so it's Ross's first plate appearance this evening. Ross started a ball game last night behind the plate and was 0 for 4. This ball toward left and Matt Holliday, one out. Now Matt Lawton will come up. 1 for 3 and a walk in the ball game. The one was a triple to left center that scored a run, his 19th ribby of the year. Right now, George, the Pirates are playing good baseball. We talked about how well they've pitched, and they seemingly got Oliver Perez back on track. They are in the midst
of their game. I mean, right, you know, don't lock him up here for winning 20. I mean, he's back on track for this ball game.
They're in the midst of playing their 10th straight ball game without an error defensively, and offensively, they have 17 runs over the last two games.
And that's huge because they had not been scoring runs and. Lloyd McClendon mentioned on the first day of the series here on Friday how difficult people don't understand. If you can pitch the baseball and catch it defensively, you're going to win an awful lot of baseball games. You mentioned earlier what their starting staff has done. The bullpen is starting to get more in line with what they're going to do. Mace had 13 straight saves before he lost two heartbreakers in a row to the Cubs. Otherwise, this club would be over 500 right now. And I think that's another indication that they're headed in the right direction. And it says McClendon said a couple of years ago we were the Rockies. We were a team with a bunch of young players trying to struggle through a season. And he said over time it's paid off.
There are similarities because they got rid of onerous contracts. Brian Giles, great player, but he was making a ton of money. They moved his contract to San Diego. In return, they got Jason Bay and Oliver Perez. As good as Giles is, and he's really starting to hit the baseball again for one of the hottest teams in baseball, the Padres. But Bay was a rookie of the year last year. He's having another very good year. And Oliver Perez has, I'm not saying this will ever happen, but he has Cy Young stuff.
Well, he can. I mean, again, he's got that type of stuff. Mentally, whether he can get it there or not, it's a whole nother question. Consistently.
Let's take a look at our player of the game brought to you by Gatorade with two outs in the eighth inning. Humberto Cota, bases loaded in a scoreless game in the second, and he ropes a double that brought all three around. And then in the fifth inning, he hit the ball hard up the middle to drive in Redmond. Four RBIs, a career high for the Pittsburgh catcher Cota. Jack Wilson 1 for 3 takes a high strike from Carvajal.
You talk about their struggles with runs, Drew. They'd been outscored in the first inning of ball games. The opposition 21, Pirates 9. As a matter of fact, the Pirates offensively had only outscored the opponent in three innings all year long. And they have struggled to score runs.
I'll tell you the other contract that they moved. Jason Kendall to Oakland. It was a big contract, a $60 million deal originally, and there were still a couple of years left on it. And in return, one of the players they got, Mark Redmond, and he's been their best pitcher.
Outstanding. Should be far better than 3-3.
Sure. He was very good last night. 0-2 on Wilson, and the high fastball at 94. Rockies hope Carvajal, part of their bullpen for years to come. Giving them baby steps this year. Kind of protecting where they utilize him. They want to overexpose him or put him into ball games that are real tight at this juncture of his career. He's barely out of his teens. But he pitches with poise. That was a changeup, and it's fouled off.
Well, he has that excitement, a quiet excitement. He's taken the road of ears open, eyes open, mouth shut. Learn the game up here. Feel fortunate you're wearing this uniform. And try to impress Jamie Quirk, try to impress Bob Apodaca to the point that you've got enough to stay here another year and have a successful big league career and slowly move in maybe into that starting rotation, into a more prominent role in the bullpen.
Strike three on the inside corner. So an impressive inning out of the bullpen for Carvajal. A 1-2-3 inning and the punch out of Wilson. We'll go to the ninth. The Rockies down by 5. 8-3 here in Pittsburgh favoring the Pirates. Coming up after the ballgame, the Rocky Mountain Sports Report. That means Tim Ring will tell you exactly the stories they're following right now. Tim.
Exactly, Drew. Interleague play around baseball with the exception of the Rockies, of course. We'll take you on a spin around the major leagues, including stops in Chicago and New York. Also, pretty good story coming out of California. What do Ryan Sandberg, Brett Saberhagen, and Dodgers manager Jim Tracy have in common? We'll tell you about that. And also the Colorado Crush, some Arena League football on tap coming up tonight, right after this one wraps up in Pittsburgh.
Hey, Tim, your Cubbies are hurting a little bit, aren't they?
Well, they're not very good right now, but it's a long season.
That is true. Zimbrano took a no-hitter into the sixth inning, and the Cubs still lost this afternoon to the White Sox, which pains him even more. Well, Mike Gonzalez remains on the mound. Desi Relliford will lead things off for the Rockies in the ninth inning. They need a major rally. And the first pitch, a strike to Relliford. Desi 0-for-3 in the contest. The Rockies have only 3 hits. 2 by Holiday. One that left the ballpark and another one that went about 75 feet. And the only other hit in the game, Luis Gonzalez back in the fifth inning. 2 hits against Perez, so far 1 in 3 innings against the bullpen. Gonzalez stood there and was wondering why Mike DeMuro didn't call it a strike, 1-2. Again, we wish all of the best to the Hurdle family. Little Madison, 2 years of age, has suffered several seizures over the last couple of days. Clint back with his wife Carla and baby Christian, tending to Madison at Children's Hospital. 2-2 inside, 3-2. And our thoughts and prayers remain with the Hurdle family this weekend. Chop foul. On the ground at Jack Wilson. One out. This copyrighted telecast is presented by authority of the Colorado Rockies and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of the Colorado Rockies. Pinch hitter for the Rockies will be J.D. Closser. On the outside corner. Well, tomorrow, Joe Kennedy against Josh Fogg. Fogg is 3-2 with an ERA of 3.77. Joe Kennedy 2-4, trying to get that ERA down. He's at 7.51 so far. Got to win his last time out. That's a pretty good lefty arm, George Gonzalez.
Impressive a year ago when I first saw him here. It's tremendous velocity and a pretty good downer. Good curveball. His velocity has touched 95 in this game tonight.
And he ties up JD. So Clauser's gone for the second out in the ninth inning. Bank One game summary. And all the positive notes favor the Pittsburgh Pirates, with the exception of Matt Holliday breaking up a no hitter with a 2-run home run that came in the fourth inning. Perez was pretty sharp with the exception of the 4 walks. Barmas takes a strike at the knees. A rare hitless night so far for Clint. 0-for-4. Curveball. Slowly hit, and the throw to first is in time. So the Rockies go quietly in the ninth, and they've now lost the first two here in Pittsburgh, 9-4 and 8-3. And the Rockies fall to 2-17 on the road. Perez the win, Jennings the loss. Welcome to the Rocky Mountains.